So he's very closely related, associated with the Jews, and he himself is a Jewish, of Jewish religion and Jewish origin, publicly embracing Islam and attempting, claiming to be an Islamic reformer. But all his army is from Middle Asia, from the people whose faces are Mijan Mutarraqa, like the ones who invaded before, the Mongols and the Turkmenic people, including the Chinese and the Korean and so on. That's the majority of his army. All the leadership and heavyweight is the minority of the Jews, which we see also that now the Jews are settling in Middle Asia and having economic interest and so on. And also the Jews of Isfahan are interacting with that considerably. So all this is, seems to be slowly preparing the direction. How long it takes? Years, decades, centuries? Nobody knows. These things sometimes take centuries to work out. But obviously he will threaten. He will issue threats that he will attack to ease the pressure on his allies. And he has other allies in China. But it turns out that this rumor or this claim is not true. He will not attack yet. But this will be effective in preventing the Muslims from further conquering to Europe. And it seems to be there's another branch which will try to conquer towards Roma itself, Roma, city of Rome. So these two, it would be really a very big two-pronged attack. Maybe one across the sea, maybe from Libyan, Tunisian area, reaching up to Rome, and one from after the big battle there in the north part of Syria, going all the way in Asia Minor until Istanbul or Constantinople location. So obviously the Muslims will take this threat seriously and they will stop the attack, but it will go several years without anything happening. Then a Dajjal attack will come. And then the events about the Dajjal, which some people have confused that he will be conquering almost Arabia except Mecca and Medina. It seems to be the strip of Hijaz all the way to Palestine and the West, thus meaning African side of the Muslim world will be not conquered by him, but he will be even reaching up to Damascus and up to Palestine and Mecca and Medina, these areas. He will come very close. There's a narration that he will be even going up the mountain of Uhud in Medina until his people look at this white palace. At the time, it was not white. Look at this, which looks like a white palace. This is the mosque of Muhammad. It was at the time not white. Now it's white. It's completely white, as we know, done with marble, white marble. This is the, but he cannot enter Medina. But the munafiqs and the hypocrites will join him, join forces. So they will be leaving Medina and joining his forces. So he will appear as a reformer, he's claiming to be a reformer, a man of peace. He will call himself possibly the Prince of Peace. Maybe he will get a Nobel Prize for Peace. That's all possible, because these prizes are given to the biggest criminals under the cover of the peacemaker. So he'll be the peacemaker, the Prince of Peace. And this is also some of his pseudo titles in Judeo-Christian tradition. And then he will claim to be a reformer. Then he will claim to be a religious leader, then a prophet. Then he claimed divinity. We have to interpret that a little bit more in modern context. Maybe he will claim divinity in the classical sense. He will claim, I have the right of legislation. I can abrogate laws. This is divinity, an Islamic definition. So, and say, I am your Lord, I am your Rabb. Rabb meaning the one who gives commandments, the one who defines good and evil. So it's not necessary that he claims he's the creator of the universe or something like that. Nobody will buy that. But many people, and obviously technology and science will be in such his time so well developed, that he will order the clouds to rain. Oh, we have no cloud seeding. It's not effective yet, but soon it will be really well controlled. And orders the places not to rain, so the people will become desolate and having no rain and no agricultural products. So anyone confronting him will be suffering all kind of hardship, including no clouds, rain. So he will be having weather control. Even he will be able to revive someone, kill someone and revive him. Obviously, medical science and transplanted will be so advanced that he will be able to do that. So many stories like that are he will be able even to have holographic records of certain people and then get the holographic records to talk to someone telling him, yeah, he's your Lord, you should worship him, you should obey him, and things like that. So we have really technology and so on indicating things which in classical scholars were struggling to understand these things, assumes that sometimes it's a satanic phenomena, sometimes it's a miracle, but a miracle which should not deceive anybody, because if he claims he is a god, and obviously he's not even able to cure his own eye, because he's one-eyed, then he cannot be a god. So such a miracle, anyone can answer, okay, if you can revive the dead, then fix your own eye, something like that. So with such a miracle, even by divine permission, will not be sufficient deception. I don't think most of these things are based on assumption that these miraculous phenomena, but they seem to be really mostly based on technology. The Dajjal will be obviously when he sees Damascus, but he will not take Damascus. And that's where many people make the mistake, that the one leading Salah there is Al Mahdi. That's one of the standard mistakes that made it. But we know that the Mahdi is not like that from the other better narrations. Then, on one morning, at Salat al-Fajr, Isa will descend carried by two angels, and then he will come. The Imam is about to start Salah, start Iqama, and then he hears the sound of something descending. He turns and sees Isa. Obviously, the Imam recognizes him. He's aware about this story. And stepped back so that Isa can lead the Salah. Isa said, no, you lead the Salah because it had been a Qama for you, and it is to show the honor of this Ummah, you are Imam for each other. For this Salah only, obviously. Later, Isa will be the Imam, but you lead. So it's a symbolic act that I am part of the Ummah, not a new prophet with a new message. So he prays behind them, then he gets out to confront the Dajjal. The Dajjal, when you see him, recognize the mortal danger and try to run away. Obviously, maybe possibly retreating. But Isa pursue him until Palestine, and he will kill him personally. The narration said that he would show the people his blood on in his sword, on his harma, in his arrow, or something like that. That could be exactly as it is, or metaphorical, that he show evidence that he killed him in person. Close after that, my assumption is that the Dajjal, being from these the leader of these Mongolic, like Middle Ages, let's say, well, Kazakhstan, for example, or Uzbekistan, is a close ally, obviously, of China. There's a cousins in matter of ethnicity, and possibly he's also coming from leftist background, improving human conditions, distributing wealth, and so on. Very nice slogans, very nice. And they, the Chinese, are as usual very conservative. They don't go out of their country. And they're relying on the Dajjal will sort the world for them out, and they will just be controlling from far away by a remote. Now, they get the news, obviously at that time news will be broadcast in a few seconds, that their staunch ally who has the courage to invade and rule all the Muslim world from Middle Asia all the way to Arabia has been killed, and his army has been dispersed and defeated. They find no other solution except to attack by themselves, to exit. And they come in such numbers, this is Gog Magog. So Gog Magog is China, possibly with Korea and Japan. They will solve their problems, their cousins ultimately. But this will be another major battle. So we have the major battle, Malham al-Kubra, this one. The fight with the Dajjal is another major battle. And the last one is Gog Magog. And in that, Isa will be fortifying the Muslim lines, again the same line, which is north of Hijaz, south of Palestine, Egypt, and so on. And the Hadith say that he will fortify take the Muslim to Atur, to the mountain or Mount of Sinai, which is not necessarily in the current Sinai. It's most likely this is a wrong specification, most likely North Saudi Arabia, North Arabia, the Mount of Tur. But it's around that area anyway, not far away, just few hundred kilometers from each other. That will be like this mountain range will be like the confrontation line, and they will be under siege, will be under great difficulties until Isa supplicate to Allah, and then these Gog Magog, Chinese, Japanese, Koreans will be attacked by some kind of worm which attacks the neck, and the whole army will be exterminated in one night. So next morning, they have difficulty even getting rid of the body except by dumping at the sea. Now, is that some kind of biological warfare? Possibly. But the Hadith expressed as supplicating to Allah, and this solution is given, because as you have to fortify yourself in the mountain, there's no way you can confront this in the battlefield. Their numbers and their capabilities are beyond anyone's capability of immediate battle confrontation. So they will be exterminated by either biological warfare or by miracle means. And then after that, there will be then all international issues which have been pending for hundreds of thousands of years, I can assume safely that many who were waiting for Isa will now awake to the reality.